you please sit down? Well, good afternoon and a very warm welcome to St. Michael's Church on this Remembrance Sunday. A very warm welcome to you all and to our distinguished guests. We have here the Deputy Lieutenant of the County of Essex, Mr. Brian Burrows, Mr. Charles and Nellie Bishop, the High Sheriff of Essex, Councillor Diana Garrett, the Chairman of Braintree District Council and her Vice Chair, Councillor Lynn Walters. And can I also extend welcome to Colonel Edward R. Armistead, here on behalf of the Soldiers and Aviators Scripture Readers Association, who will be speaking later in the service, here with his wife Caroline. And finally, can I welcome my colleague, Reverend Richard Chand, Chaplain of the Royal British Legion, who will be assisting with the service. Can I just mention a couple of very practical things? I'm really not expecting us to evacuate the church, but if we had to, we would go out through one of the main doors. There are doors at the front, but I'll come and direct you in that very unlikely occurrence. After the service, there'll be refreshments over in Church House, which is just down from the church, kindly provided by the Royal British Legion. I hope that you've got sight of one of the service sheets. And as we begin, an opening introduction. We have come together to worship Almighty God, to offer him praise and thanksgiving for our nation's deliverance in time of war, to recall to mind those who through death, injury or bereavement, suffered to bring peace and freedom to our world, to seek his forgiveness for our failure to achieve reconciliation between the nations, and to ask for strength to overcome evil and injustice wherever it is found. Our opening hymn is on the sheet, Great is Thy Faithfulness, during which the colours will be brought forward. Well, we have volunteers here from the Air Cadets and the Army Cadets who are going to read two poems to us. So I wonder if Cadets Johnson and Perfect could come join me, and Cadets May and Ardron, please. Keep faith and walk in the way of your God. restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our next hymn reminds us that there have been many signs, and I'll be speaking about some in a moment, many signs of God's deliverance for our nation in times of war. We stand to sing, O God, our help in ages past.
The weather was not good. But
miraculously, as had been the case when it was the evacuation from Dunkirk, and would later be the case on D-Day, the weather lifted providentially at the right time. Commander Anthony Kimmins was one of those who prayed and related how it went. He said that it happened with barely an hour and a half to go before 0 hour. The wind suddenly dropped. The white horses went down, and the swell went down quicker than I had ever seen it do before. It was so sudden that it was unbelievable, and as people stared into the darkness, it seemed miraculous. As if, well, put it this way, many a silent prayer had been offered up. Having invaded Sicily, the Allies then turned their attentions much further up Italy to a town called Salerno. It's just south of Naples. As they prepared to invade Salerno, by this stage, the German army were there in strength, and they were waiting for them. And there was reported in the newspapers the next morning, the 9th of September, a headline named "The Miracle of Salerno." And the following account is from a reporter. "I was with our advancing troops in the invasion of Salerno on Monday. The enemy artillery was advancing rapidly with ceaseless firing. The noise was terrible, and it was obvious that unless a miracle happened, our troops could never hold up long enough for a beachhead to be established. Suddenly, for no accountable reason, the firing ceased and the Nazi artillery stopped its advance. A deathly stillness settled on the scene. We waited in breathless anticipation, but nothing happened. I looked at my watch. It was 11 o'clock at night. The significance of the time was that many people had been praying at this time. Still we waited, but still nothing happened. And nothing happened all that night. But those hours made all the difference to the invasion. By the morning, the beachhead was established." These were just two examples of, I believe, God's deliverance of our nation and of the Allied nations during the horrors of the Second World War. But let me hand over now to my colleague, Reverend Richard Chan, as he leads us in prayer.
When I say, "Lord, in your mercy," you say, "Hear our prayers." Almighty God, from whose love in Christ we cannot be parted, by death or by life, hear our prayers and thanksgivings for those whom we remember today. Fulfill in them the purpose of your love and bring us with them to your eternal joy. We give thanks today, O Lord God, for all that makes our common life secure, for the peace and freedom we enjoy, and for the opportunity that is ours of building a better order of society for those who are yet to come. We remember with pride and gratitude those who fought and died to make this possible. We pray that the memory of their sacrifice may inspire us and the resolve to speak and seek your kingdom and to do your will for the world of our day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, make your church an instrument of your peace, teaching by word and example the way of reconciliation. Bless those who are working in areas of conflict to bring people together in the name of Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Dear Lord, bring peace to all the places of strife and violence. Fill the hearts of those in authority with the true love of peace and the desire to work for harmony with those who seem to be their enemies. Bless the organizations that seek peace between nations. Lord, in your mercy. Dear Lord, give us peace in our homes, with our neighbors, and in places of work. Inspire us with the love for others, which may spread through them to heal the wider problems of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Dear Lord, have mercy on the victims of war, the wounded, the refugees, those who have lost everything they had. Be with those who have no more hope, and restore them to the fullness of life that is in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. We pray for all who have died in war. Grant mercy to those who died unprepared. Through the love of Jesus, who died by human cruelty, give the peace which they were denied in their last hour. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. We make our prayers in the name of Christ, who has left his peace to his faithful people. Amen. We say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
As Christians, we believe that God's love was shown to us uniquely in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. And we talk about God's grace, that is God's undeserved favour to us. And our next song reflects on that. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. We stand to sing.
Now, after the Sabbath, towards the dawn,
the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me."
Different places at different times over the ages.
457 servicemen and women who were killed in Afghanistan. It would be surprising if, in a gathering such as this here this afternoon, there is not just one person remembering in a very personal sort of way and poignant way a loved one killed in action. We will remember them. Death has an awful finality about it, doesn't it? It results in the separation from loved ones, and it causes huge sadness. But what is death? What are we to understand about death? Well, the Bible speaks about death in different ways. First, there is physical death. All of us, of course, will die physically one day. Of that, there is no doubt at all. But the Bible describes death for the Christian as simply falling asleep. For example, the Apostle Paul writes to the Thessalonian Christians, "We do not want you to be uninformed about those who are asleep." And so when a Christian dies, all that happens is the body and soul separate. And this separation is very well expressed by the old American spiritual. John Brown's body lies mouldering in the grave, but his soul goes marching on. So the Bible speaks of physical death, and it also speaks of spiritual death. The Apostle John writes, "Whoever has the Son, Jesus, has life. Who does not have the Son of God does not have life. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life." John was summarizing the teaching of the Lord Jesus about those who are alive physically, but dead spiritually. And who are those who are dead spiritually? Well, they're those who, through their own choice, are separated from God. They may say that they believe in God, but that's not evident in the way in which they live their lives without reference to God. They will not acknowledge that while they justly deserve God's judgment on the cross, Jesus Christ himself took the punishment that they deserve. And so, of course, they don't follow Jesus' teaching. In a word, they do not have the Son. And the result of mankind's failure to follow Jesus is the chaos and strife that we see all around us today. In the family, in our society, in the school, in the workplace, and between nations. We sinful human beings are the cause of all that's wrong in this world. And as long as men and women continue to reject the Lord Jesus Christ, there will always be strife and fighting. Only when Christ returns in power and glory to bring his eternal kingdom of peace will the nations give up all. So the cenotaph is a symbol of death. It speaks of the failure of mankind to be able to live together in peace and harmony. And by implication, it tells us that the world is as it is because of mankind's refusal to submit to the rule of the Lord Jesus in our hearts and lives. But there was another cenotaph that was and is a symbol of life. Jesus' tomb, his kenos taphos, his cenotaph. When Mary went to Jesus' tomb on that first Easter morning and peered in, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay." And that's the most wonderful good news, isn't it? In today's culture, that would be an obvious headline for the Easter Day newspapers. He has risen.
Mary had gone to that tomb full of fear. She'd witnessed the horrible death by crucifixion of her friend, Savior, and Lord, Jesus. And she was now separated from him by that seemingly irreconcilable chasm, death. But when she arrived at the tomb, she was told, "He has risen." The empty tomb of Jesus, his kenos tapos, his cenotaph, the fact of the resurrection is the central truth of our Christian faith. Viewed apart from the resurrection, the death of Jesus upon the cross was a tragic failure. The empty tomb is the incontrovertible proof that Jesus is God and that God himself died on the cross. But why was his death so important? Why was his death so necessary? Well, God is a loving God, of course he is. But he is also a just God. And he can't simply turn a blind eye on our rebellion against him. This must be punished. And on the cross, Jesus has taken the punishment that we deserve. And when we acknowledge what God has done for us with penitent and grateful hearts, God himself restores the relationship broken by our rebellion against him. When a person truly receives Christ by faith in their heart, not only spiritual life, but eternal life become their immediate possession. In the Bible we read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." Isn't this an amazing promise, a glorious prospect? In the light of this promise, it's hard to understand why people still reject God, still refuse to accept that Jesus is their only hope. And the choice for us then is to remain burdened by the guilt of our rejection of God, to remain separated from God with little prospect other than to endure the chaos and turmoil of the world around us, or to submit to the Lord Jesus Christ. To acknowledge our past rejection of him, to beg for God's forgiveness and mercy, and then to look forward to an eternal future with him, where the Bible tells us there will be no more death, nor mourning, nor crying, nor pain, for these things will have passed away. Albert Einstein was a famous theoretical scientist who lived in the last century. It was his formula, E equals mc squared, that had made possible the atomic bomb, which when dropped on the Japanese city of Hiroshima on the 6th of August 1945, killed 78,000 people instantly. Einstein was chatting with a friend one day, and he spoke of his despair that his scientific research had resulted in the death of so many people. He grew silent and looked very sad. And his friend said to Einstein, "So you don't believe there will ever be peace?" "No," answered Einstein. "As long as there will be man, there will be wars. There really can be no peace in the world until mankind is at peace with God. And that peace is only gained when we repent of our sins and trust in the saving death of the Lord Jesus Christ." Today we remember and give thanks for all those who have died, that we may enjoy the freedom that we live in this country today. Freedom from tyranny and strife. But let us not lose this opportunity to think about what causes war. It's the sinfulness of the human heart, our rejection of Jesus. And so in closing, may I urge you, before it is too late, to give careful consideration to your response to the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus. For this very afternoon, the Lord Jesus is waiting, wanting to give eternal life to all those who put their faith and trust in him. Let me pray. Father God, as we remember and give thanks today for all those who died for our country, that we may live in freedom, help us by your Holy Spirit to acknowledge the sinfulness of our own hearts. And in your mercy, may we gaze at the cross of the Lord Jesus with gratitude and faith, knowing that he died that we may be truly freed from the burden of guilt, and that we can be sure of our eternal destiny with you. And we ask this in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. going to happen next. In a moment I'll say a final prayer of blessing, and then we'll sing the national anthem. After that, I'll lead the official party out. And do please, if you're able to, come join us in Church House, which is out of that door, down to the left. It's the old vicarage across the road for refreshments. The Royal British Legion are kindly providing for us. But a closing prayer. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love. Defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace.